everyone. My favorite part of information technology is that, like, we spend so many money, a lot of money, and unfortunately, we don't have anything working yet, like, working good. Anyway, like, hello, my name is Andrei Sitnik. I will talk about CRDT today. My grandfather was a sailor, so this is why I like ships. But unfortunately, I'm not a sailor. I am lead front-end developer in a consulting company called Even Martians, but at least the name of the company is better than most of Soviet Union spaceships. most of Soviet Union ships. Too many space here. Yeah, but you can know me as a creator of PostCSS after prefix here and browser list. Yeah, thank you. I created after prefix here in 5 years ago. Sorry, I announced it only in Russian that time. 5 years ago, the whole generation. And right now, it's one of the most popular NPM package. Like, it have more downloads than React or Webpack. The reason is very simple. We just put PostCSS in Webpack. So every Webpack user is a PostCSS user. You know, promotion and cooperation. But main problem that right now, PostCSS doesn't need changes. It works pretty well for the task that we are trying to solve. And it doesn't need to change anything. We just need to maintain, you know, only to remove node version support to keep you updated. And so this is why I feel very bad, because like PostCSS grew up and doesn't need me anymore. This is why, after a few months of depression, I found that I must to find a new goal, some new project. And this is a problem. Like, what will be the next trendy stuff? Of course, like, if you're looking for trendy stuff right now, GraphQL is a cool thing. It's really great stuff. Like, a lot of people told you here, like, really, I completely agree with them. It's really great technology. There is only one problem. The most of the problems in GraphQL are already solved. They have a task, and they solve the task. They're cruel. Right now, the only problem they have is to promotion. I don't want to say that promotion is like to see these things. No, I really respect people who only promote the code because it's one of the hardest work. But this is not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for some question without answer, for some challenges. And this is why I start to think, what will be after GraphQL? What will be after REST? What will be the future technology? And in Kyiv, I found a solution. I saw a talk from Viktor Grishenko. He is a mad Russian scientist, creator of Swarm.js. And I really was convinced by his talk that CRDT is a future after GraphQL. Of course, I'm not sure, like, all of this is just a prediction, but at least I believe. We should believe in something. But I will try to convince you as well with very interesting way. I saw that most of the technologies, the revolutionary technologies, they have the same steps in the past. First, they was created just for non-standard, very small task that nobody cares. But this non-standard task was so non-standard, so like the current technology will not be able to solve it. So they go and find some very old, very forgotten technology, very forgotten theory from the past to solve this problem. But then, after they solving this small problem, they found that that theory could be applied for bigger problems. And this is how a lot of revolution was made. For instance, how America was found. They just tried to find a way to India before the Portuguese will find it around the Africa. And they tried to think, like, there is a very good old idea that Earth is a sphere. And so if Earth is a sphere, why are we going around the Africa? Why we can just go in the opposite direction and visit the Japan and then India? Very tricky way. Unfortunately, they have a wrong calculation. It's very long way. But they tried to do it and found completely new world. It was very same with React. Facebook created to solve the problem with notification count because it was always in the different state of the, like, with the rest of the data. And they found a functional programming. Functional programming was created in 60s or 70s. It was very old technology. A lot of people like them, but nobody really used them, used functional programming. By then, Facebook used functional programming to create the small problem with notifications, and right now they open a completely new world. My favorite example is Redux. Redux initially was just an example for Dan Abramov talk. On this talk, he tried to explain how to use React Hot Reload in the best way. And to show it, it found a very nice idea from Elm. The whole ideas behind Redux was created in Elm community. And so he brings this idea from non-popular but very interesting project, and we have Redux right now. So let's do the same three steps. Our first step will be finding some non-standard problem. To-do application. Of course, to-do application is the most standard problem. It's not a like unique way. We need to create a to-do application with likes, with numbers, with description for each task. Very simple task. You know, we all ready for this because like the all guides, the all examples showing to-do applications. So this is a perfect task for you. So you just use Redux, then you use for instance Fetch API. When people create a task, you send the AJAX request, create action to show the loader, and when AJAX request will be completed, you will show the result. Very simple. Or maybe you will use GraphQL because GraphQL is cool. You will create a mutation, same way to show a loader and to show error. But then, and you did it. Like, where is my money? But then client ask a small extra additional step. The client want that multiple users will be able to change the same document at the same time. Of course, you can do it. You can create some hacks around GraphQL, do a lot of stuff, increase the complexity. But to be honest, you will not solve the problem with GraphQL. You will have complex code, and unfortunately, a lot of problems, and you will have no sleep because you will fix the problems because of the collaborative text editors. And so instead of trying to use current technology, let's go back and start to think again. Let's go to the dungeons of computer science and try to found some cool forgotten theory that could be applied for our task. And there is this theory. It's called distributed systems. It was created a long ago. Okay, let's talk about distributed systems. Our current approach is that we have our client side. Client side is very good. We have great frameworks. Then from our client side, we send a request. And to be honest, we don't care about who will proceed this request, how it will be proceed. We just don't care about requests. We just send it to no land. And a lot of developers even forget the loaders to proceed the mistake or some error. Distributed system is completely different theory. Distributed system means that every part of your application, web application, server and client, they are part of the one system, and you just synchronize the state across the whole system. So let's try to implement the idea of this theory to our application. Like first problem, what if two users change the same task? One, how we can merge this data from these two users if two users send the whole state? It's completely, like, it's very hard to do it. It's very hard to write algorithm. But there is a very interesting idea. If your algorithm became very complex, it means that you must change your data structure. Good data structure will make your algorithm simpler. Data structure is the key. So instead of sending a state, let's send actual changes. And right now, in this case, when two users change the different fields, we even don't need to merge it. We just need to take these two actions and put it into one array. That's all. There is no even algorithm behind it. It's an idea called event sourcing, by the way. And in our system with Redux, Redux action will be this event. Redux action is what is an object that contains what actually was changed in our application. So we use our event sourcing, we send to the server what was actually changed, and it means that we send to the server the Redux actions. And this is a very important part of this talk. So, why it's so important? First, we don't need any loaders. Let's remove it. We don't need a jack request. Let's remove it. We don't need migrations or saga. Let's remove it. We don't need even a loaders. Loaders, I hate the loaders. Every time you press a save button, you see this loader, and you spend a lot of, like, you must wait until do something to finish some another task. Let's remove all of that. And instead, we will keep WebSocket connection between our client and the server. And in this WebSocket connection, we will use to synchronize the Redux action. Every time when we create Redux action, we apply it to the interface. For instance, if user changed something, we apply it immediately. And in background, we send this Redux action to the server by WebSocket. So there is no any loader. It's called optimistic UI, created the idea was very old, but the term was created by Google Wave. Who used Google Wave? Oh, yes, there's still people here. Yeah. Developers of Google Wave create the term of optimistic UI. So this action will be sent to the server by WebSocket. Server will save the changes to the database, but in the same time, it will resend the same Redux action to every client that connected to the same server. And vice versa, if the server can send us actions from other client, we can create a Redux action on this server because we have a Redux, because we have a WebSocket connection. So it means, I don't know, a Redux on the server. I understand that you are a little angry right now. Like, you're Russian, why are you so optimistic? Optimistic UI is not capable for all cases. What if we have some, I don't know, what if our task manager have some payment feature and user must to pay something? And we can't make optimistic UI for payment procedure. We must to show that we are taking money from your account. It's not a problem. With same approach, we can do pessimistic UI as well. But we can do it not with request, but with two different actions. One Redux action will create a loader and will send it to the server. So server will receive this action, take all money from our account, from user account, and when money will be ended, he will send an extra action that will say that there is no money, send it for donation. And our interface will show that money was taken. So the same pessimistic UI could be applied, but you must apply it only in critical part, not everywhere like now. Okay, next pessimistic problem. No internet, like here, like in this venue. There is no good Wi-Fi, right? What if you will do something? And it's not a problem. First thing you must do, you must show some warning that there is no connection, but you must to allow user to change to continue to work with your application, to change the data. Why? Because Redux already have a system to keep your action in the memory. And so when the user will have a connection, we will send the data. It's not a problem. Okay, the most pessimistic scenarios. What if our database didn't allow us to save the data? What if name was already taken, or I don't know, somebody burned the whole server? And again, Redux already have a solution for this case. In Redux, there is a very amazing stuff called time traveling. And any moment, Redux, because it saves all your actions, and all reducers are pure function, in any moment, the Redux can roll back some of your actions, remove some action from the history, and then roll it again, like it was never happened in the past. So we can use the same approach here. When user asks us to change the name, we change the name immediately. At the same moment, we send action to the server. Server unfortunately found this name was taken and sent a special action to undo that action. And we, using the same technology as a lot of people using right now, remove that action of renaming from the history and show the original interface. It's already implemented, it's already used by many people. Okay, idea looks awesome. To be honest, it was created in the after party in St. Petersburg when we drink with Dan Abramov. And on after party, when you're drunk, all ideas are cool. Unfortunately, it's not in the real. And the real ideas could be, you know, when you try to implement it, sometimes it's a little harder. So we create a system when we have a lot of clients. All of clients can create actions by their own without asking a server, and only then they will try to synchronize it across the whole system. So we have a system with multiple actions rounding around. And how we can guarantee that these actions will have the same order on every client? If the order will be different, the final state will be different. And to be honest, in distributed system, even event source, if you have this problem, it's much easier to just remove the whole system and start again. So we must to use some time, some timer, to make an order of our actions, to keep the order. And now my favorite part. Unfortunately, time is a lie. Time is very bad system to keep the same order. Why? First, because time is not unique. You can generate the same timestamp in the same moment. My favorite part. Sometimes next time could be smaller than previous one. It happens by many reasons. For instance, time synchronization. But my favorite reason is leap second. Every year, the special committee look the real orbit of the Earth this year and add or remove one extra leap second. So most of the years we have an extra second. So in the end of the year, you have a one special second to finish everything that you didn't have a time this year. And unfortunately, in the most of the systems, this leap second means that you have 1 second rollback. And CloudFront have a big problem with this 1 second back. They have a big problem with scalability of it. And of course, third problem, there is no time synchronization right now. All clients could have completely different, completely weird time, and it's hard. So the problem why we have this situation is that we read only a first letter of distributed system, like use event sourcing, and start to implement it. If we want to have good distributed system, we must go back to the dungeon, take full book and read the full book, not just first papers. So, and these books recommend us very amazing part. Just throw away the time. Time is a lie. There is a very good project called Logical Clock, created more than 40 years, about 40 years ago by Lamport. He even got a Turing Prize for this technology. It's really amazing work. And the idea is that we don't use a second, hours, or months. We use a counter. Unique client idea. Every time when we generate time, we increase this counter. Very simple. But also, if we receive action from other client, we will look what counter the other client used, and we'll increase our counter to be bigger. So when first client create action with time number one, second client after synchronization will increase, and then we'll generate time with two. And in the end, they will all use three because they create a time in the same moment. This is why we use unique client idea to have unique timer everywhere. With this timer, we have this good distributed system, and we don't have a problem of different order because the timer will keep the same order. It will guarantee it. Okay, unfortunately, it's not the all problems. Last but not least problem, edit conflicts. Okay, I show you a very simple example when different users change the different fields. It's too optimistic. Unfortunately, some of you may be angry and like really want to ask me, but what if two users in the same moment will change the same field? Especially how we can manage collaborative description editing, because it's a big text. We need to allow people to change it in the same moment. Yeah, it's a complex question. Because it means that we must answer how to make our Redux action atomic so they will not have a conflict with each other, how to make it atomic x maximum. Back to the dungeons. And we found a very interesting paper called CRDT. This is a reason why I put the faces of the creator, because when I told this talk previous time in Porto, after a talk there was a guy who started to ask me a lot of questions to try to explain the mistakes in my talk. And I, man, why do you explain my mistakes just after a talk? But then I found that he is the creator of CRDT. So right now I put the faces and I remember it, and if it happens, I will be prepared. So it's very recent work. It's not so old as Logical Clocks. It was created just about 9 years ago, but of course a lot of frameworks changed because we are living in front-end. CRDT, it means conflict-free replica data types. So it is a list of data types. These types are very different. Some of them use distributed timer, some of them doesn't use. Some based on the actions, some based on the final state. But all of them has a limit, they're not silver bullet, and they have a list of operations which you can apply to each type. Main idea behind this type that every client could create own action without waiting for server. Every client can change the data. No gods, no masters. But in the end, when synchronization will be complete, they will have the same state. Even if other client create change the name to the different value, because have he created earlier, only that client will win, because last twice wins in this case we use. So instead of changing likes to exact number, we will change our action. We will use actions to add and to remove likes. Okay, it is simple, but how we can change the text? First idea, we'll create actions for each symbol. Every time when we delete or add symbol, we'll create a special action with the time, with the position. But here is a problem. If we will use index swifted always time when we remove or add something. So when first user delete letter number one, the other letters will have a different indexes. And so actions from the different client will not be reasonable anymore. This is an example. First user delete letter number one, second delete add a letter after the first letter. And as a result, like, it's completely mess because we change indexes every time. So we must go to CRDT and find the best option. And there is this option. We just must to keep indexes persistent. So when first client removes the first letter, other letters will not change the index. And same when second client add letter I, H, we will create indexes between left and right. In this case, we can allow users to change the text in the same moment. Of course, if we will change the same letter, it will be last right wins. So very predictable. Unfortunately, CRDT is not a silver bullet. Sometimes you will need to create some different types. So use CRDT as inspiration, not as a guide, like 100% sure. So what we created? We use Redux or Vuex or any other pure reducer state management. We put a distributed time for each Redux action. We synchronize this action between client and server by WebSocket. We use time travel to remove actions which could not be applied or to put actions in the middle if some other client created like an hour ago. And we use CRDT to make our actions atomic. With these rules, we make a very good collaborative text editor, or we make a very good collaborative to-do app. But maybe we create some different technology. Maybe we create ideas that could be applied in different cases. One example, like if a user in our to-do apps clicks too fast on the checkbox, it will generate two actions. And we send two requests to the server. Unfortunately, network doesn't guarantee the order. And in many cases, the order could be different. So as a result, server will receive it in the different order. And as a result, unfortunately, we save in database wrong state, not as predictable state for a user. And it's not a problem for CRDT because every our action have a time. So when the order will be different, our server will understand that this action from the past and will ignore it. Of course, this is just a small example. But this small example shows more important part, that Ajax and GraphQL is created for ideal internet that works only on your laptop when your backend and frontend in the same machine. Unfortunately, the real internet is a little different. And CRDT was designed, it was by design created for this type of internet. And as a result, it works much better in China. My family live in China. I would like to visit them, to eat borscht from my mother. But unfortunately, half of the packages to any Western website, even if it's legal, if it's not blocked, half of the packages will be lost because it's censorship. Or New York, there is no internet, it's in subway, so you have the same problem in the city of United States, in this capital of United States, biggest city of United States. Of course, next billion people will not have the good internet. And so all this CRT technology, they will make you more client, your user. Chinese user will be able to use your application with better user experience. People in New York subway will use it in better user experience. Even next billion people will be use it in better user experience, and more users means more money. But why it's designed for the bad network? It's designed for bad network because CRDT is peer-to-peer protocol. So technically, it could work even without a server. It also means that you can create the master-master replica in your server side because CRDT was designed for use multi-master replica. Or in our frameworks, if you open the browser, if you open the website in the multiple browser tabs will elect one leader, and only this browser tab will keep the connection. And all other browser tabs will listen to this leader browser tabs. So some sort of multi-master replica on the client side. Of course, or you can do some mesh crazy stuff. CRDT is able for this because it was designed to be peer-to-peer. And as a result, with CRDT, you have a more option for scalability. Of course, most of the use cases, you will have a single source of truth, you will have a single database, but in other cases, you will have option in CRDT. Second reason, optimistic UI require a lot of stuff. You can't use optimistic UI without offline first. And you can use offline first without predictable conflict resolution. And CRDT is a way to have a predictable conflict resolution. And CRDT was originally, by design, created to be able to work with optimistic UI, with offline first, and with live updates. And as a result, with CRDT, we'll have a very good designed optimistic UI. And as a result, with optimistic UI, you will have live updates. So with live updates, your users will have less mistakes. Or more important, performance is really a money. There is a lot of research that performance is important for, if you improve your performance, you improve your profit. And with optimistic UI, you will improve performance of your interface and it give you more money. And right now, CRDT becoming a trend. There's a lot of companies that try to use it. But my suggestion is to use CRDT not for some special cases like multi-master database replica. My suggestion is to use CRDT for any big application because it's a way how we can improve user interface, how we can make completely different internet with much better user experience. This is why right now I'm developing a new framework for CRDT called Lagax with nice logotype. But there is not only a solution. There is a lot of other solutions created by many people. It's like a lot of things happen in CRDT world right now. So join us. Join the revolution of CRDT. This is my Twitter. This is Twitter of Evil Martians. Thank you.